Today we will begin the last category of physics, namely quantum field theory. One might ask, why do we need it? Isn't quantum mechanics enough? The answer is that regular quantum mechanics is not compatible with Einstein's theory of special relativity. This simply means that if you want to describe how small quantum objects move at velocities at near the speed of light, then we can't use regular quantum mechanics. As mentioned in the video about the hydrogen atom, we need quantum field theory to get the most accurate model of atoms. More importantly, we need the framework of quantum field theory to discuss the standard model and the three fundamental forces, namely the strong, weak, and electromagnetic force. This video is therefore to help introduce some core concepts of quantum field theory. The obvious thing to start with is the name of the subject at hand, quantum field theory. It is clear that quantum refers to the fact that we are interested in quantum objects like electrons and quarks, a bit like in quantum mechanics. We are thus interested at describing the smaller scales in the universe, meaning at distances smaller than a nanometer. Quantum also means that we use operators, just like in quantum mechanics. The word field refers to the fact that we now describe the world in terms of fields for all the objects we consider, which is also what is done in relativity. We thus have a field for the forces and the matter in the world. As an example, we have the electron field with electrons and the photon field with photons, which also represents the electromagnetic force. These fields stretch throughout space, and the particles we observe are what we call excitations of these underlying fields. Finally, we have the word theory. As it is with physics in general, we work with theories describing reality. We don't actually know if what we do is correct. In general, we will discuss what is called perturbative quantum field theory, which has proved very accurate. But we actually also know that these quantum theories which we use today are fundamentally wrong. But for all practical purposes, they work just fine. Before we go any further, I would like to note that when discussing quantum field theory, we will be using what is called natural units. In quantum mechanics, we got used to seeing Planck's constant h-bar all the time. Likewise, we also encounter the speed of light, c, a lot when discussing the theories of relativity. Since quantum field theory combines special relativity and quantum mechanics, we can expect this constant to be everywhere. To clean up the notation, physicists have come up with natural units, which simply means that h bar and c is equal to 1, such that we simply do not write these constants. This also means that the unit we are working with is electron volts, EV. This might initially seem like a strange idea, but it's very handy. We can always convert any result to SI units by multiplying with C and H bar appropriately, but this is rarely necessary. One of the ways to formulate a quantum field theory is to start with a classical field. A convenient way to express a theory is in terms of its Lagrangian. One of the simplest examples would be to consider a scalar field, phi, with the following Lagrangian. L is equal to 1/2 phi dot squared minus 1/2 and the Laplacian of phi squared minus 1/2 m squared phi squared, where the first term is the time derivative of the field, the second term is the derivative with respect to the coordinates x, y, and z. These are the kinetic terms about how the field moves in space. The last term is the mass term, containing the mass of the field. This is the potential term. If you're confused about the Lagrangian formalism, you can check the video from Newtonian Mechanics about it. This equation is like a recipe for a very simple theory with a scalar field changing in space with some mass m. The next step is to consider the Lagrange equation with respect to the scalar field Lagrangian we just introduced. Then we can obtain the equation of motion using the standard procedure of this formalism, and we obtain the equation where we have the time derivative squared minus the Laplacian plus m squared, and then all this multiplied by the field phi, and this is equal to zero. This is a very famous equation known as the Klein-Gordon equation, but so far it is only for a classical field. The next step is to quantize the field. This is called the second quantization. In a simplified way, this is simply the process of converting a classical theory into a quantum field theory. The goal is to define a many-body quantum system with some number of particles. First, we can rewrite the classical result of the Klein-Gordon equation using a Fourier transform, where we write that phi of x is equal to the three-dimensional momentum integral divided by 2 pi cubed times 1 over the square root of 2 e subscript p, and all this multiplied by a subscript p times e to the power of minus I p x plus a subscript p conjugate times e to the power of I p x, where x is now spacetime. E subscript p is the energy of the modes, and a subscript p is some normalized constant, and a subscript p star is its conjugate. The subscript p refers to the modes, which can be considered as the modes of a harmonic oscillator. We thus consider all these modes of the fields as small springs. In a similar way to quantum mechanics, the essence of the second quantization is to rewrite the equation with the relevant operators. This is generally not the full story, but it works in this case. So let's do that. In this case, we simply promote a subscript p to being an operator, and the same with phi, and write phi hat of spacetime is equal to the three-dimensional momentum integral divided by 2 pi cubed times 1 over the square root of 2 e p, and then all that times a hat subscript p times e to the power of minus I p dot x plus a hat p dagger times I p dot x. And this is essentially all there is to it. We now have quantized the field with the creation and annihilation operators ap hat and ap hat dagger, where the hat means that it is an operator. These operators are used to create and annihilate particles, and we now have a field with quantized particles instead of modes. In a simplified way, this is all there is to quantum field theory. These new creation and annihilation operators has the following commutation relations. The commutation relation between ap hat, aq hat dagger is equal to 2 pi cubed times the delta function between p and q. The last bit is a delta function. A delta function is rather simple. If its argument is 0, thus if p is equal to q, then it is equal to 1. Otherwise, the delta function is 0. We also have the relation that ap hat, aq hat is equal to ap hat dagger, aq hat dagger is equal to 0. Thus, only the commutation relation between a creation and annihilation operator is non-zero. The Klein-Gordon equation might be very simple, but further inspection reveals that it satisfies both Einstein statistics. This means that this simple theory can explain spin-zero bosons. This is not far from the quantum field theories of the Standard Model. Now I would like to take a break from the math. The quantum field theories of the Standard Model are a bit more complicated, but a lot of what we discussed today can be related to it. There are also other important aspects to the study of quantum field theory, and that is symmetries. And that topic is so important that it deserves a video on its own. The essence of symmetry is that if you perform some transformation on your field, such that the field looks the same after transformation, then the field is invariant and has a symmetry. The astonishing thing about this is that according to Noether's theorem, each symmetry corresponds to some conservation law. A few examples could be time translation. If your theory is invariant under this transformation, then you have conservation of energy. If your theory is invariant under translation in space, then you have conservation of momentum. If your theory is invariant under rotation, then you have conservation of angular momentum. There are many other and very important symmetries in quantum field theory, but we will discuss them in a separate video. This video aims to introduce you to what will come later and give you a bit of the math working behind the scenes of quantum field theory. Because the math is generally rather complicated, we will often not go into the details, but now you have seen some of the simple stuff. I also quickly mentioned symmetries. These are incredibly important in fundamental theories, and actually they form the backbone of the standard model. If the math was a bit too complicated, maybe watching the video about the Lagrangian formulas and the Pauli exclusion principle could help. As always, please comment, like and subscribe. If you want to support me, check the link below and buy me a coffee. Otherwise, stay tuned for more videos.